Welcome to an all-new episode of Tell You Later.
If you were expecting the unexpected, you may not be disappointed. Or will you?
Sincere thanks to all those who support us on Patreon. And there's always room for more.
Do not forget to hit the like button. Don't forget to hit like right now.
Hit it!
We haven't got a title song for this show, so we're singing this thing instead.
Okay.
It's really just a substitute. Nonetheless, the melody may stay in your head.
Oh, I hope so.
'Cause it's a tune.
It's a tune.
You'll love to croon.
You'll love to croon.
Ah, but there's one thing you should know. We have to confess we do not possess a title song for this show.
Ain't it peculiar?
Believe it or not, we haven't got a title song for this show.
Oops.
Important announcement. Please note that in this episode, whenever Katie or I mention Eddie Arnold, we really mean Eddie Albert. The similarly named gentlemen each played guitar and sang. But whilst Eddie Arnold achieved fame and popularity over many years as a beloved country singer, Katie and I are actually referring to Eddie Albert, whose fame and popularity came primarily from his Broadway film and television performances. Our sincerest apologies. In the meantime, enjoy this episode of Tell You Later.
Wow, that's cold water. Do you like to swim in cold water? Do you like to swim in the ocean? Do you ever go to the ocean? Do you, in fact, live near the ocean?
I've heard of it. Which one?
Why don't you go to the ocean? You live in Santa Monica.
No, I live in the Hollywood Hills, legally.
Yes, but you're often in Santa Monica.
I'm often in Santa Monica. That doesn't mean I'm often in the ocean.
Why don't you go to the beach? Do you go in the ocean?
Why didn't Mohammed go to the mountain?
Because the mountain came to Mohammed. No?
Because it didn't come to him, so why should he bother to go, right? So,
do you like to swim in the ocean? That is a very simple question.
Oh, was that the question?
Yes.
I used to.
And then what happened?
Then I noticed that there's a big sewage thing right next to where I was always swimming.
That thing,
I thought, boy, am I a dope? Because I wondered what that was.
I know.
There's no signs posted. There are lifeguards every, eighth of a mile or something, and there's people cavorting in and out of the water,
it's only really
so
bad
ignorant.
After a storm. And when was the last time we had a storm? It's a storm drain.
Well, we're in a drought now.
But you could go swimming. You don't have to go to that spot, you know.
That's true, but it was easy to walk to, and it still is.
Well, that's great.
It's Ocean Park.
But if you want to
I used to walk along the beach every day for a couple of years.
Yeah.
Around 7:30 in the morning or something like that. And I would be the only person there, generally. In 2 years, I think I saw three other people. And I'd walk by these, houses and condos and hotels. And I'm thinking, people are paying a fortune to live near this ocean.
And they're not outside.
I won't name which ocean it was.
But it starts with a P.
It does. And one of the more famous oceans on the planet.
A big one.
On this
it's
planet.
A big one. My mother-in-law when she came to visit, I brought her down to Redondo Beach and she looks at it, she goes, that's a big ocean.
Did she have, her little implements out?
I think she's used to the lake, but Lake Michigan looks like an ocean.
Yeah.
It looks like an ocean.
I wonder what Balboa thought when he saw this.
It's a big ocean.
So I used to walk that every day, and I think all these people are paying all this money to be here. How come I'm the only one here on the beach?
And you're not even paying.
Yeah. Of the three people I actually saw, I knew two of them, one personally and one by...
they were famous?
One by repute and by whatever.
Does that
although
mean they smelled?
It turned out we had mutual friends. And it was a fellow who was running by, and this is while Ronald Reagan was president. And this guy came running
back
by.
Back when the world was in black and white.
And No, it was in color.
Oh, it was in color.
But it was on bad videotape. Mm. So
VHS. And when the world was on VHS.
And it's a fellow whom you would know too, and many of you would know.
Can you give us a hint?
His initials are Eddie Arnold.
Oh, I thought you were going to say yes. I'll tell you later.
No.
Because you were going to give me a quiz.
I am.
For
I'm going to do that. Yes. We have a new format mm-hmm. for the show. We're going to begin, which we haven't begun yet, but we're going to begin.
As soon as we begin, get ready.
We'll let you know when we begin.
Uh-huh.
With a question, which will be posed by one of us.
Which will be answered at the end of the episode.
Right. Assuming we remember.
And we will, because guess what?
Swat.
I have a pen and pencil here.
Oh, well, there
pencil
you go.
A pencil and paper.
That's why they have those in court,
Did
too,
I say
I
a pen and pencil? I meant a pad and pencil.
A pad, man?
A pad.
Hey, cool pad.
Yeah, thanks. I think it's pretty cool.
So it's Eddie Arnold.
Eddie Arnold. Hey, I'm going to tell you something for honest to good truth.
Okay, good, but Can I finish this story?
Eddie Arnold,
I'm walking along the beach.
Yes?
And occasionally, you know, leaping aside as the tide comes in a little, you know, a little beyond what it usually was.
Prancing.
In the meantime, this guy comes running on the beach,
mm-hmm.
and he's in about a foot of water, you know, and that's his thing. And he's in a swimming suit just running along the beach. And it's Eddie Arnold. So we wave at each other. And because we're the only ones there.
And it's a nice thing to do.
How come he isn't president? I don't understand. Ronald Reagan's president. And I guess.
Did you say, hey, why aren't you president?
So I ran up to him and I should have.
Yeah.
But
It's a reasonable question.
He plays the same kind of parts, kind of a nice guy, you know,
mm-hmm.
and in movies as Ronald Reagan used to play. Then he got older and he started playing villains, actually. His last movie was called The Killer,
Ooh.
And he played a killer.
Well, guess what?
Ronald Reagan.
Eddie Arnold in a restaurant. I was eating it in Puerto Vallarta, Mexico.
Really?
Yes. I had won a trip on $10,000 pyramid.
Maybe
show.
He won the same.
Maybe. No, I was on the show. It was a prize trip to Mexico.
No,
and
we went to Puerto Vallarta. Really?
Yeah.
Wait,
you were
on a game show?
Yes.
Do you have that footage?
Uh-huh. It's really sad. I was so.
Don't
if you think I'm bad on this show with my partner,
uh-huh.
I was horrible to my partners on that show. And I really didn't. There's a story behind that. I'll tell you later.
Okay.
I'll tell you write it down at the end of this episode.
Okay. Oh, good. Because I had a question for you, but I'll save that for the next time.
The game show story. Okay?
Okay, game show story.
All right.
She's going to tell us later.
Yes.
So Eddie Arnold.
So
now, those of you who don't know, Eddie Arnold was
green.
A singer.
I thought you were talking about the Green Acres.
He was a singer and a guitar player, but yes, most people know him from Green Acres.
Oh, phew, I'm glad we're talking about the same person.
Yes,
okay.
Right. And he was Mr. So-and-so. He's the wealthy New Yorker on Green Acres.
Oh, well, his name was... I know Crow of One Nose.
I know his first name.
Darling.
Oliver.
Yes.
Because I used to have a car where when you're backing up, it goes do-do-do, do-do-do, do-do-do.
Because that was Ava Gabor played his wife.
Right. Yes.
New York is where I'd rather stay. I get allergic smelling hay. I just adore a penthouse view. That's what it is. Darling, I love you. But you
okay,
no, we can't
yeah,
sing
right, right.
it.
They'd shut us down.
But that's what, but, see, that, you know, people say to me, and I'm just going to divert
I never heard you do,
slightly
Ava
a little
Gabor.
Bit.
Uh-huh.
You know, how did you get into voiceover? Or what did you do? Well, I used to imitate. I thought, you know, I do this great Ava Gabor imitation when I was 11,
heard you do
right?
It. You've never been paid to, have you ever done that in a cartoon or anything? Probably not.
I don't
Doesn't come
know.
In. Huh. Wow.
Remember.
Isn't that funny?
But yeah. She, you know, we tried to sing like her. Because I was talking about this with the Crew of One, that all of
it's
the shows we watched
Singspiel.
Growing up.
It's Singspiel, because she doesn't really hit notes. Right?
Like Rex Harrison.
Rex
right?
Harrison and yeah. most of it. But he does hit notes now and then.
Yeah.
Or she, I think, didn't.
She might have, but
maybe,
she was so
she
funny because she had this great Hungarian accent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, all the shows had theme songs. Now they just have music. But I think a lot of the shows we watched growing up had theme songs.
Yes, because and they were fun because they told you the story, a three-hour tour.
Yes, you know? Or and this family got together and soon they had a hunch. There's that theme song. Mm-hmm. And The Courtship of Eddie's Father had a great theme song.
Really? You know, I always used to ask... Red Buttons, Whatever Happened to Miyoshi Umeki.
Oh.
And I asked him 1 year, and then 10 years later, I asked him the same
thing. Was that his wife?
No, but he won the Oscar playing...
Sayonara?
Yeah.
Is that what the movie was?
Which I saw when I was very little.
Yeah, my family, too, and they said, this is very sad.
Yeah.
Very sad movie.
It's a really good movie, and Marlon Brando's in it. And you know, The Officers Club? The Officers Club in that, which is in Japan? It's really just above the Magic Castle.
Oh,
it's Yamashiro Restaurant now.
Yamashiro.
But it used to be a place of interesting repute, and it was a number of things. But it played the Officers Club
in
the film.
Yeah. Well, we were watching an old movie this weekend. I watched The Odd Couple from 1968 with Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau. That guy. What expressions, Walter Matthau.
Yes.
I mean, what a malleable face.
Yes.
This is, wow.
And I don't know if when he was studying acting, he realized how good he was at because he was doing dramas for years, you know, people.
He's a really good sloucher. He had this weird posture.
He became increasingly,
schlubby.
You know who he lived next door to?
No.
Since there are people who watch this program or listen to this program who are interested in animation, I'll tell you later.
I'll tell you right now. Or if you want me to tell my story, you could tell that later. Do you want to wait?
No, I'll tell
you my other story?
No, I'll tell you right now.
All right, go ahead.
He moved into a piece of property on Toyopa Drive in Pacific Palisades.
About Walter Matthau.
Walter Matthau.
Okay.
I would say this was probably in the 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And then he bought the house next door also.
Because he could. Yes.
And then he spent 3 years, or the crew spent 3 years turning it into one house, knocking everything down and turning it into this giant house.
Ginormous mansion.
Yeah. And
did he have many children or just?
No, he just had many
collected
money.
Collected a lot of many money.
Yeah.
Okay.
And he had a notoriously beautiful wife.
Oh.
And, or famously beautiful. I think that's a better word.
Yeah, because that sounds like she was bad. Evil beauty.
Well, yes, I think she was so appealing. I think she'd been married to maybe Frank Sinatra or something. She'd been married to. And maybe one of the Marx brothers. I might be messing this up a little bit, but she was quite a hostess.
Somebody better fact check this episode.
Yeah. But anyway,
so
3 years.
A beautiful person.
3 years working on this on building this into one gigantic house, and the guy next door. If you saw him, you'd recognize him from the radio as the mailman on the Judy Canova show, as the poor put-upon mailman. Or if you saw him, on the radio as Jack Benny's violin teacher, you'd recognize him as that. And if you saw cartoons, you'd recognize him as the voice of Bugs Bunny and. Daffy Duck and other characters.
Perhaps we're talking about Mel Blanc.
Mel Blanc lived next door to
Walter Matthau.
Yeah, he lived next door to some house, and then Walter Matthau moved in and spent all that time.
Mm-hmm.
So Walter Matthau spoke at Mel's memorial.
Oh.
And talked about what a nice guy Mel was, how he bought the house next door and spent 3 years fixing it up, and how Mel never complained.
Aww.
Yeah, so.
Well, that's
never complained to him.
He didn't have to record at home like voiceover actors need to do now.
Of course he did.
He recorded at home?
He had his own business then. He was recording commercials in his house.
My ear.
Oh, yeah.
Mel did. You know,
Noel, I was old tape recorder.
Well, Noel, his son, had a recording studio at his house in Beverly Hills, and he lived next door to Michael Douglas. And I tell you, that's one of my first voiceover gigs.
Is that why they were on the plane together? Were they on the plane together when it crashed?
Oh.
Michael Douglas
took
off.
They were good friends. Because I think I told you this story. If you've heard this before, stop me. But my stepmom worked at a hair salon in Beverly Hills, and Noel, Mel's
hair salon, 1-0.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
And so he was a client, and he was looking for a voiceover. She must have talked to him saying that I was interested in voiceover, and he was making a film for the Shriners Institute, about the Burns Institute, and he needed the sound of a little girl being scalded in the bathtub. And so she said, well, I don't know, we connected us somehow. So I'm, you know, like 18, 19 years old.
No fooling.
Yeah. So I drive over to their house, which was, you know, like this nice house.
Did
in
you
Beverly
meet his
Hills.
Wife?
She, Noel's wife?
Yes. Beautiful, blonde haired.
I don't think she was home.
Young woman.
But I remember going in back, and he had this little studio, and we screamed. And when I walked out, there's Michael Douglas sitting on the couch in his shorts with a tennis racket saying, are you ready? Can we go play now? I'm like, this is a weird existence I am living starting then.
Wow. So that was your first voiceover job?
I think, well, the first one might have been over at Chuck Bloor's studio.
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure. One or the other. I don't.
Wow.
I was very young, and I wasn't very serious about it when I went to Chuck's. That was like I was just really didn't know what I was doing at all. And at Noel's, I mean, I just had to sound like a four-year-old crying and screaming.
Wow.
And I guess, you know, I should look and see if that exists, because now you can see so many things on the YouTube.
Yeah.
Like us, which I got to see us on the big screen.
She hit me again,
I want to take a poll. So we were at our daughter's house, and I said, you know, I never watch our show because it's YouTube,
uh-huh.
So you can...
Watch it on the big screen.
No, I usually see it on the computer.
Screen.
I said, let's... And they hadn't, you know, I think they maybe had seen one episode. I said, let's watch it. And I was like, I'm watching us on TV, and I'm wondering how many of you guys, put the comments down below, how many watch on your computer and how many watch us on TV? Because that was really kind of, wow, look at us.
Yeah, I'd like
TV,
to do that.
Because YouTube's the TV for the masses.
And I only ever see these large screens, large television screens, I should say, you know, when I'm looking in a...
department store?
Yeah, right. If there is such a thing, or walking through a Costco or something.
I know, that's where you, because we don't have one of those really big screens. It's funny, most of the people that, I shouldn't say most. A lot of the people we work with in the industry barely watch television. They like to go to the movies, generally.
Yes, yes. That's the big screen.
We used to do that a lot.
Yeah. The silver screen.
The silver screen.
In Hollywood, we have a few silver screens. That is, screens with silver content.
Really?
You know, in the old days.
Can you get sick from that?
Up through the 30s.
Oh, no, silver's good for you.
Silver is fine, yeah.
Silver's very good for you.
And film stock used to have silver in it, and the screen had silver in it. So it was much more magical being at the movies. There was a great kind of luminescence. It just made everything sparkle.
It really was a silver screen.
It was.
Wow.
And you could go to, because if you're showing 3D, you want a silver screen. You know, so the, in Hollywood.
Next time I show 3D, I will certainly request a silver screen.
Absolutely.
Yes.
In Hollywood.
With my silver tongue. Hello. Hello. May I please have a silver screen? Oliver. Hey. Did I knock your train of thought off the tracks?
Probably.
Sorry about that.
So where was I?
Here. You're sitting right here.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
The Egyptian Theater has a silver screen.
Mm.
And I think, the Academy has a silver screen.
Ah.
Very important.
The Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences?
Yes. And
where is that? But it's not.
8664 Wilshire or something like that. 8994 or something. It's on Wilshire.
And there's the Writers Guild too there, right?
The Writers Guild has three screens, but I don't think they're silver screens. The Directors Guild, you would think, would have one.
How do you know? Do you like test it?
Oh, no, the Writers Guild has one
screen. How do you know it's silver? Just because you read about it?
The Directors Guild has three. Because knowing friends who are projectionists or who are, you know, film experts, if you're going to have a 3D festival, you would have it at the Egyptian because it seats maybe 700 or 600. And, you know, the Academy is probably too expensive to rent. You know, studios rent them all the time for events and things.
To make a big deal.
The screen there, the golden screen, I think it's called.
Wait a minute, is it gold or silver?
The Samuel L. Goldwyn Theater at the Motion Picture Academy on Wilshire.
The Goldwyn Theater
in Beverly Hills
is not gold, but it has a silver screen.
No, because it's named after Goldfish, Sam Goldfish. Do you know about him?
No.
He and Selwyn formed a company, and so they took the
beginning. It was Goldfish?
His name was Goldfish, yeah.
Yeah?
And, I mean, I once saw, I used to eat at the Friars Club, and Sam Goldwyn Jr., whose signature you see on Sam Goldwyn.
The movie. That's
his signature, because one time he signed his little chit and left. And I was walking by, and I saw his signature, and it's exactly the same as the logo, you know? I thought, oh, wow, it's his signature, not his dad's, you know? But anyway, his dad's
copying.
Name.
Let's see, what if he practiced forging his father's signature when he was young and got really good at it?
Very well may have.
That could happen.
Know, that's, he could be a graphic designer of great talent. And
that's one way of looking at it.
Or a forger, I don't know. But no, da-da-da, backing up.
Hello.
So Sam Goldfish formed a company with Selwyn, and I can't remember, was it Edward Selwyn? I don't remember.
Should I look it up?
So they made up the name Goldwyn. They took the first part of one name and the last part of Selwyn, right? And
yes.
And then...
Hold on a second. I have to text Chris
Selwyn
back.
Got, what?
Chris.
Oh, she's on her way.
No, that's okay. Someone else.
Oh,
Chris just says
so many
need
people
to catch
named Chris,
up.
Male and female.
Hi.
And all points in
we
between.
Are
but where was I?
Shooting. Tell you later.
Oh yeah. So he changed his name to Goldwyn, so people would think that he was the head of the studio when he wasn't. And that really irked Selwyn.
Well, that's kind of.
I know, but he
creepy.
Kept it.
But yeah. But wait a second. They still work together.
I think that caused a major rift.
I think it would. Yeah. I would be a little rifty if somebody did that.
Rifty.
For me, I
coined
think.
A new adjective, folks. Right here.
So Katie you want me to tell it. You my game
of course
show
she
story?
Should,
Is that, are we,
a game
are we
show
towards?
Story?
Yeah, I have you to know, tell you later.
I made notes of everything we're supposed to do in this episode.
And
we haven't done one thing yet.
But you want me to tell you about Eddie Arnold and my game show
oh,
story?
Oh, yes.
Because I made
yes.
a note.
What was the name of the show?
$10,000 pyramid.
Was it done at CBS?
I don't know. I don't remember.
On Fairfax?
This is the thing. When I work, it starts with My Little Pony.
Okay.
Okay. So it was, oh, thank you for my water.
We were in that. Or you were in it all the time. I was in it.
But there
once
are a lot
twice.
Of girls.
Yes.
A lot of women.
Close.
So one of our women, Ellen Gerstel, she
I
went
remember
on
Ellen
the. Because her husband was a writer, Gordon Brisak.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh.
Anyway.
I think Ellen Gerstel was in.
She was in.
A Teen Wolf
Poochie
series that I did.
Too. Poochie. Yeah. We did Poochie.
Oh, I haven't
together.
Seen her since then.
Yeah. Hmm. So she went on $20,000 pyramid to I don't know what. There's two pyramids.
Uh-huh.
There were two. Anyway. She studied for it. And she goes, it's really easy. We all should do it. So we used to. She could talked us all into applying
wow.
to get on
I mean,
the
all
show.
All of the My Little Pony people?
A lot of us, yeah.
Wow.
So we would practice playing the like game, because I never watched the show, but we, you know, kind of showed us how it worked, and then we thought, well, you know, this could be a fun way to, I said, well, can they let us go in, because we're union and we're actors, but you just, they
don't
were okay
it.
With saying
uh-huh.
it, actually. I think I did say I was, or... A housewife? I don't know. Anyway, because I said, how they let you get on that show being an actor? Anyway, in the industry. But they did. They were like desperate, I guess. So anyway, I managed to be one of the people who got on. I think Nancy Cartwright even practiced with us at that time.
Wow.
Who's Bart Simpson. Anyway.
The voice of.
But we were, yeah. But we were all on My Little Pony at the same time. And so I got on the show. And this is a lesson in what you pray for, because you can get what you, you know, ask for. And my mother at the time needed a new car. And I said, I hope I win a car, and I hope I win a trip. But I never, like, was, like, hoping for money. I don't know why. It just, that seemed too greedy for me. But I thought I'd love to go win a trip. I'd love to win a car. Well, sure enough, and I didn't play that game very well, and I was like really, like I said, if you think I'm awful with him, I was like yelling at whoever the star was who I didn't recognize who was my partner, like, that was a stupid clue. Anyway, I was really bad. I do have footage,
did
and
you,
I'll show
did
you.
Did you hit him?
No, I didn't. I don't think I hit him. I think one's name was Bert Convey. And then and then this lady, Mary Hart, not Hartman, Mary... Hartley?
Marion Hartley?
Oh,
she's
like
a wonderful actress. Yeah, she's still around.
Blonde? Is she blonde?
Yeah, yeah. She's most, oddly enough, she's most famous, not for the Twilight Zone she did, but for and she did so many things, but for doing those commercials with James Garner, where they got along so well that everybody thought
like
it was his wife.
Oh, like credit card commercials, maybe? Anyway, no, I don't think that's who it was. Oh. Never mind. It was a different lady. Forget it about her. Anyhow, so this lady's my partner, and I managed to win a trip to Mexico.
A what?
A trip to Mexico and a car. I won a car, the Ford Taurus, which I was so happy to give my mother. I was happy I won a trip. But then when you win stuff on a game show, you have to pay taxes on it.
Yes,
and
right.
so if I had only like envisioned winning some money to cover these dang taxes because I gave my mom the car, then I had to pay the taxes on it because I won it. So it kind of cost me a little bit. But we did win a trip to Puerto Vallarta where I did see Eddie Arnold at a restaurant there.
Great.
So that's my story.
Oh, man. Eddie Arnold.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was great. You know my friend Miriam Nelson?
Mm-hmm.
Remember her? Miriam, she was a Broadway dancer and then came to Hollywood and became a choreographer at Paramount and worked with everybody.
And we're going to wrap this up, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll talk more about her next time.
Okay. And speaking of dancers, stay tuned because we're going to be having a dancer on one of our episodes very soon.
Oh, that's right.
We
next
have
episode,
a special
we're
guest.
Gonna, we have a new season coming up. After episode 26, we begin a new season.
Which is only going to be better. Promise.
Especially if we get more Patreon support.
Yes. So thank you, everybody who supports us on Patreon. We appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. We really do. And we've got some great ideas for next season, which we'll tell you about next time.
Right.
And they all cost a little bit of money.
Money, right? But we'll tell you later.
Tell You Later is a Patreon-driven entertainment show. So what are you waiting for? Come on over. Join us at patreon.com/tellyoulater.
That it's out of kind of you, that the birds are all singing and the bells will soon be